Everybody, it's great to be here with you all this morning, and it's great that my video worked. So it's really fun. I love to be able to show you guys some pictures and some video because I can talk a lot, but if you can actually get a glimpse of what it actually looks like there and what we do, I feel like that's so much more valuable to you as you pray for and support us in all of this. Fazenda Chinkombe means Chinkombe farm, and what this is an outreach into an unreached tribe in the south of Angola called the Mungambwe tribe. That is an area where there has never been historically, never been any missions presence, never been any missionaries there, no churches, no exposure to the gospel. It's actually a people group and a language group that still doesn't have a written translation of the Bible in their language. So what happened is that back during the war years in the 70s and 80s in Angola, the Union of Evangelical Churches got together and asked the government for a big piece of land right smack dab in the middle of Chinkombe territory. And they got this land grant. It's a pretty big, our ministry property is pretty big. So it's 40,000 hectares. Our perimeter boundary is 57 kilometers. So it takes a long time to ride my horse around the perimeter boundary to check that fence, let me tell ya. So this big piece of land is right in the middle of this tribal territory, and the Mungambwe tribe, ordinarily, they're very transient. So they're subsistence farmers and herdsmen. They come and they go with the grass and with the rain. So if you want to minister to this people group, you need some way to bring them all to one place. And at Fazenda Chinkombe, we do that through providing services and providing employment. So in post-war Angola, it's becoming increasingly a cash economy. So that means that if somebody wants to send their kids to school, they have to be able to pay school fees. If they want to be able, if someone is really ill or needs a surgery or needs to go to a doctor or they have malaria, they need to be able to pay for those kinds of services. And most Mungambwe families have no cash money because every year they farm the food that they need to feed their families, but they have no way to earn money. So what we're doing at Chinkombe is offering internships in employable skill sets. So we have like an internship program in carpentry, auto mechanics, crop and cattle management. We provide adult literacy, so most of these individuals have never had a chance to go to school. They don't know how to write their own names. They certainly won't be able to read the Bible when we finally get it translated, so we offer adult literacy programs. There's a school for the kids. We have a clinic. We're the only health outpost within a couple hundred kilometers in any direction. We have a little airstrip, so we can fly in a doctor when there are cases that are too severe for our clinic to handle. So it's a pretty neat ministry because it's holistic. It reaches out to the whole family. And of course, though, we really strongly believe, and I'm more convinced of this than ever, that a ministry that meets the physical needs of a person or a people group but doesn't meet the spiritual needs isn't really an effective Christian ministry. I mean, we have a lot of awesome NGOs. We have a lot of awesome programs feeding the hungry. What we have is unique. We have the love of Jesus Christ, right? And we definitely don't want to neglect the physical needs, but we also don't want to neglect the spiritual needs. So what's really cool, what happens is we offer an employment opportunity. For example, we need another person or two to build fence or to clear land or to herd cattle. So we put the word out there to the villages. And then somebody comes to Chinkombe to fill that slot. And we always joke that we get like, you know, 10 for the price of one. We pay one man's salary, and he comes and he moves onto our property, moves into the village with his family, with his wife, with his kids, with a couple cousins or nieces or nephews, maybe an elderly aunt or an uncle. So we get the whole family group that comes and lives at Chinkombe. And while they're there, then their kids have access to the school, their wives have access to literacy, they learn a trade, they're paid a salary all through their internship. We give them all the land they want to farm, we provide plows and oxen so they can take as much land as they want to farm for their own use or to sell the produce. And what normally ends up happening is that after a few years of living at Chinkombe, once they have a trade, they're ready to move on, and they go out and they get a job somewhere else. And here's the cool thing, is that most of the time, we've been able to introduce them to Jesus while they've been there. And when they go, they take that with them. And a perfect example of that is this guy we called him Tio Paulo, which means like Uncle Paulo. But he joined the farm ministry, the farm workforce, when he was a young guy. They said 16 or 17. He's actually not sure how old he is. He has no record of how old he is. But Sterling, my colleague who started the whole thing, Sterling says he thinks he was 16 or 17 when he first moved there. And this was like back in the first years when they first got the property and there was nothing there. There were no buildings, nothing like that. Sterling and this group of like young workers used to be there, and they for the first year they lived in tents, and every night they'd sit around the campfire, and Sterling would tell them about the Lord, and he'd read the Bible to them. And this young guy Paulo got saved around the campfire with Sterling, and he's worked at Chinkombe down through the years for like 25 years. He got through, like, he got all schooling and everything, and he was actually able to take distance correspondence courses from the Bible school in Angola in the city and get ministry training while he was working. He got married. He has a Christian family. He has a whole passel of Christian kids. And he's actually became the carpenter, the master carpenter at the carpentry shop. So he was teaching internships to other young Mungambwe men who came and wanted to learn a trade. And then here's the awesome thing. Tio Paulo, a couple of years ago, we really miss him, because a couple of years ago, he decided it was time to move. Some of his family in another village were becoming elderly. He needed to go there and care for them. So he left Chinkombe. He went to that other village, like an hour and a half's drive away, where there was no church presence. He started a church. He's planted a church there, which he's pastoring. And to support his family, he's running a carpentry shop. Now, isn't that incredible? So that's what I find is so exciting about Chinkombe, is that it's not a flash in the pan kind of outreach. It's a long process of discipleship where we get to walk beside people and support people as they discover their identity in Christ, are discipled into Christian maturity, and then are launched out to take that with them wherever they go. So it's pretty cool. I wish I could transport you guys there just for a little bit to see what it looks like. We're in the most idyllic situation. We're out hours away. We're hours from town, out in the bush. Little dirt roads to get out there is so beautiful. But I mean, it's not all a picnic. I've been there now. I guess it's about 9 years at least since I first went there as an adult. I also grew up overseas. I'm a missionary kid, like Jared was saying. But when I moved there like 8 years ago, I had no idea what I was really getting myself into, you know? I had never been overseas as a missionary as an adult by myself, and I especially never had any idea what it would be like to live in such a remote area. And, you know, I didn't know how intense the spiritual battle would be. You know, here in Canada and in the Western world, I think a lot of the time the strategy that the enemy uses is to be really, really sneaky and really subversive. You know, he works under the surface. I think he just loves to lull people into a false sense of security. But over there, boy, this is an area that has been the property of the kingdom of darkness for a long time. You know, we are moving into villages and areas where traditionally the witch doctors are still there, you know, and you have this direct confrontation between light and darkness in these places. And the spiritual warfare that goes on, there's nothing undercover about it. It's out in the open. And it was such a shock to me and such a surprise to me. You know, I remember one time I was getting ready to go preach, and I had the opportunity to speak in the village church there. And we have a healthy village, just to say, we have a healthy village church there. About a third of the population of the village is there in church every Sunday morning. About half of them are children, so that's pretty exciting. When I started the Sunday school program, we had about 120 kids within the first month, probably. And that is literally, just so you know, that is literally every single child, like above 2 years old, within like a two-hour walk. Like some of these kids would come on Sunday afternoons to come to Sunday school, and they would walk 2 hours there and back just to be there. So it was super cool. But anyway, what was I actually saying? Rabbit trails, right? So it's really neat to see how out in the open that spiritual warfare is, because we get to see the power of God in action, right? And it has given me so much more confidence in my walk with God, and as I go through these things. This one time, like I was saying, I was going there to preach, and the Angolan church is quite legalistic. There's a lot of this feeling that, oh, you know, you have to perform a certain way. You have to, if you make a mistake, you're out, you know? And I was going there, and I felt the Lord had laid this message on my heart of freedom and of love, and I was going to be talking about the verse that says there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, right? And I was going to be talking about salvation through grace, that it's not based on a decision to try to be a better person. It's about Jesus superimposing his holiness and righteousness over our sin and making us right before God and including us into the fellowship of the Trinity, right? So I was really excited about this message. And then about 20 minutes before I walked out of the door to go and preach this message, I got hit with this like wave of sickness. Oh my goodness. I was like dizzy, tunnel vision. I thought I was going to pass out. I was so sick to my stomach. And I thought, oh man, I can't go preach. And then I thought, wait a second, this cannot be coincidence. So I went outside my little house, and like there was nobody around, so I didn't have to feel like a crazy Christian person, like, you know, super spiritual nonsense. But I just thought, you know what, this can't be coincidence. So I'm standing there outside my house, and I just started to pray out loud, and I said, Lord, like, I've memorized the Bible verses that say that no weapon formed against us will prosper. Lord, I've pinned them up in my house, the Bible verses that say that if we submit ourselves to you and we resist the devil, then he has to flee from us. So then I just said, you know, in the name of Jesus, I claim the full work of Christ on the cross and that victory. And in submission to God, I resist you, enemy, and you have to leave, and you can't interfere with us, and you can't interfere with our service, and you can't make me sick in the name of Jesus. And the sick feelings all went away, and we carried on. We had our service, you know. But this is like all the time, nonstop, always going on, right? And I remember another time, this was just before I actually arrived at the farm, and they told me about it. It was a recent happening when I first got there. There had been a young woman, 14 or 15 years old, who came to the clinic with her significant other, her husband, her partner, and she had started having seizures. She would lose consciousness and fall to the ground, and and, you know, writhe around on the ground. And she was really worried because they were worried that she was going to have a seizure and fall into the fire when she was cooking one day or something. So they came to the clinic. And the doctors did a bunch of tests, and they said, well, you know, you don't have malaria. You don't have anything else. And so they pressed her a little bit more about her story. And it turned out that her grandmother had been one of the dancing women for the village. So the dancing women are like the female version of a witch doctor. So they're the ones who perform the ceremonies and do the dances around the fire. And they will actually, they'll receive payment to cast spells on other people in the village and cast them and remove them and so on. And this elderly grandmother, when she was dying, had passed on the mantle of this role to her granddaughter and had told her granddaughter, you know, you're going to be the next dancing woman for the village. And had passed this on, and they had done a ceremony and sort of a transfer of power to the young girl. And it was at that point that she started having her seizures. So the missions doctor, of course, he said, oh, well, that's actually great news, because now I know what's wrong with you. What's wrong with you is that you're being oppressed by an evil spirit. And that's actually brilliant, because you can get rid of that. All you have to do is commit your life to Christ, accept the lordship of Christ over your life, and the Lord will come, and he will live in your life, and you'll have the power of Jesus in your life, and that'll mean that nothing else can have that power over you, and you'll be free from this. And you know what? She actually decided that she didn't want to go through that process because she said, well, wait a second. If I give my heart to Jesus, and does that mean that this spirit has to leave? And the doctors were like, well, yeah, and that's why you're going to stop having seizures. And she actually decided, she said, no, I think I'd rather keep the power and just live with the seizures. And she went on her way. See, the choice that she made right there was the choice to build her own kingdom rather than relinquish that for the lordship of Christ. So she knew that she had a way to make money, she had power over other people, people respected and feared her in the village, and she wasn't really willing to sacrifice that. But I tell you, boy, my heart breaks for that girl, because that's a bad road that she's chosen. You know, down the road, she's going to be regretting that. And I hope and pray that she remembers what was said to her. And down the road, when she really needs help, I hope and pray that she comes back and seeks out that church again and says, you remember what I said I didn't want back a long time ago? I want that now, right? But that's the kind of overt spiritual warfare that we're facing. You know, I wasn't prepared when I moved there for how much like home that place would come to feel. That village and those faces. You know, I was so privileged. I was able to take these little kids. Okay, I got to say, though, quick aside, I don't enjoy kids ministry. I'm not the Grinch, but I don't love kids ministry. And, you know, in Bible school and stuff, I was always saying, like, Lord, I'll do whatever you want, but I don't want to do women's ministry, and I don't want to do kids ministry. And when I first moved to Angola, I thought I was going there to start a horse breeding program as another business, and this whole business as mission enterprise for the agricultural center. And when I got there, Sterling and Donna said, you know, I know you want to start with youth and you want to do the horse stuff, but we really need someone to do kids ministry. I was like, dang, okay. So I started this Sunday school program, and that grew really fast, and I did that for a few years. And then I was able to get into youth discipleship stuff. Oh, and I also ran a women's group the whole time I was there. I tell ya, God has a sense of humor. But I was so neat because I was able to have these little kids. I was back in Angola quickly last summer, and I ran into these young women. They came into our Sunday school program as little kids. And, you know, Jared and the team here would be familiar with this, with all the camp and kids ministry. It's a remarkable privilege. They got saved in the kids ministry when they were little. Then they became junior leaders in the Sunday school and the kids ministry. And then they joined the youth teen girls discipleship group that I used to host in my house every week, every Tuesday night. We'd come and we'd cook traditional food together, and then we'd have a Bible study. And then they joined the women's group. And when I went back to Angola this past summer, I got to see them. And they're there with their first two, all of them, all three of these particular girls I'm thinking of, have their first two babies already. They're married, and they're like leaders in the church. And they're also like 18 years old, but ages are different over there. And I just thought, wow, Lord, like what a privilege to be able to just be there. You know, I don't take credit, but man, to be there to witness that, that's incredible. Those are Christian families that hopefully are going to pass down this Christian, this mantle of Christian blessing down through the generations. I pray that that's what happens there. So it's so neat. I also didn't expect that I'd get as sick as I got while I was there. I had malaria 5 times in 8 years. One of them was cerebral malaria, nearly killed me. And then at the end, I ended up with dengue fever, which earned me a 2-year sabbatical in Canada to recover. And that's where I am right now. I'm just finishing that health leave, and I'm heading back over to Angola for another 6-month posting here in the next month or so. But I didn't expect it, you know. I didn't expect how wonderful it would be, and I didn't expect how hard it would be. But you know, the truth is that I think a lot of us, we don't really know what to expect. We don't really know what it means, maybe even, to be a disciple of Christ. I think a lot of the time we do the same thing that that little demon-possessed teenager chose to do. We choose to build our own kingdoms instead of partnering with the Lord and obeying Him and building the kingdom of heaven. And I think that we maybe don't understand that we're not as Christians. You know, when we said, how many of you prayed a prayer like this? You know, Lord, I invite you into my heart. I give you my life. Lord, forgive me from my sins and, you know, make me a part of your family. I give you my life. I think a lot of the time we forget that we said those words to God. We said to Him, I'm giving you my life, right? But we sometimes, I think, we just go through the motions and we treat it like an add-on. But look at what the Apostle Paul called himself. In the beginning of his letter to the Romans, Romans 1:1, he said, he identified himself. He said, I, Paul, a bondservant of Christ. Do you know what a bondservant is? If you're church people, you probably have heard this before. A bondservant is a willing, lifelong servant. So what would happen was, if there was a servant or a slave of a particular wealthy landowner or master, say he was there, he'd been working with that for that man for a long time, maybe he was married there, maybe he had kids there, and then the time came when he could have his freedom if he wanted it. Maybe he had served his term of service, or he'd had enough money to buy his freedom. And he'd have the option to go free and go off into the world and live a different kind of life. But check this out. Look at Exodus 21:5 and 6. If the servant declares, I love my master and my wife and children and do not want to go free, then his master must take him before the judges. He shall take him to the door or the doorpost and pierce his ear with an awl. Then he will be his servant for life. So that man, he could make a decision. He could say, I would rather be a servant for life than have my freedom. And that's the word that Paul used when he was talking about his relationship to Christ. He said, I'm a bondservant of Christ. And you know, look at John 15:14-15. Just in case you're feeling like, ooh, servanthood, slavery, those are not good words. Look at this. This is Jesus. Listen, you are my friends if you do what I command you. I no longer call you servants because a servant doesn't know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I've made known to you. See, this is how Jesus responds to us when we offer our servanthood to Him. We say, Jesus, I want to be a bondservant for you. I want to be completely belonging to you forever. And He says, wow, awesome. I'm so excited about that because I can do so much awesome stuff now in you and through you. But don't worry, you're not going to be a servant. You're going to be a friend. Right? And the cool thing is that when the bondservant gave up a certain things, he gained certain things. So he maybe was saying, you know, when he made that decision and they did that legal transaction, what he was saying was, okay, I'm giving up the right ever to own a house, ever to own land, ever to organize my own life, decide where I'm going to go every day, what I want to do. But in return, the master was saying to him, okay, and my commitment to you is that from now on, I am going to provide for you. I'm going to house you. I'm going to feed you. I'm going to clothe you. I'm going to provide for your family. I'm going to provide for your wife and your children. I'm going to give you meaningful work. I'm going to send you here and send you there. And everywhere you go, you're going to go with my authority. Everybody will know you go in my name. They'll respect you because you carry my name. You're my bondservant. And the other thing is, if anybody came against that man or his family, the master would bring the full force of the armies and the armed men of his house and his estate to protect them. Boy, not so bad to be a bondservant, right? Not so bad. Boy, compare the two lives. Here is a bondservant as an example. Bondservant of a good, wealthy, fair, just, loving master who says, I don't call you servant, I call you friend. And here over here is maybe a person who maybe he has nothing. Maybe he's living in the street. Maybe he's scrounging for food from the gutters, saying, yeah, at least I have my freedom. No one can take my freedom from me. Who would you rather be? Boy, I'll tell you, I'd rather be a happy servant of a good master than cling to my right to run my own life. The great cosmic struggle of the ages has been for lordship. Think about it. Think about the fall of Lucifer. That was when Lucifer said, you know what? I'm not okay with being subservient under God. I want to be better. I want to sit on the throne. It was a struggle for lordship. And in the Garden of Eden, right? In the Garden of Eden, when Eve took and ate the fruit and gave some to Adam and they both ate it, what they were saying was, we want to be like God. We want to know everything that God knows. We don't want to just trust and we don't want to just obey. We want to know. We want to have the right to make our own choices. Even though we have all this other fruit around us in the garden, we want that one. And almost like a little toddler, you can't tell me no, right? How often do we do that? Boy, in our Western culture, this is something that stands out to me in stark relief because I've been living in some other cultures, right? We are so individualistic and we are so stubborn about having the right to run. No, you can't tell me what to do. You can't tell me what to think. You can't tell me what to feel. You know, you'll offend me and then I'll post it all over the internet. But that's not the case. You know what? Submission is not a bad word. Servanthood is not a bad word. Obedience is not a bad word. You know, look at this other verse, Matthew 6:24. This is a verse that I find a little bit sobering and difficult. Sad. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You can't serve both God and money. And here he's talking specifically about money, but this is a principle that's true across the board. You can't serve two masters. And we're believing a lie if we think we can treat God as an add-on. If we think we can sit on the throne of our lives and just have God kind of squeezed in beside us, like on Sundays you can sit on the throne with me, or, you know, sometimes. Discipleship is not like a gym membership. It's not just something that you add on to an already full life. You know, a gym membership that it's mildly beneficial, it makes you feel good about your health, it's not too expensive. That's not discipleship. Discipleship requires everything of us, and it gives everything back to us. It's a lifelong, all-encompassing commitment. And when I was praying about this service, and I asked, like this was just last night again, and I was like asking the Lord, you know, just, what would you speak? Any changes you want me to make to these notes and to the direction of this message? I felt the Lord bring one word to my mind so strongly, and it was lordship. Lordship. I desire lordship. I desire lordship in your lives. Nothing else should be Lord in our lives but Him. That is a role that is reserved only for Him. He's the only one who can do it well. He's the only one that I would trust in that role. But that means that if I am a bondservant of Christ, my bank account isn't mine, my car isn't mine, my time isn't mine, my house isn't mine, my dreams aren't mine. And I think a lot of the time we beg for the blessings of the faith, but we don't accept the lordship of Christ. You know, we ask to receive answers to our prayers and healing for our bodies and protection and peace in our circumstances and provision in our finances. But we're not willing to receive his discipline and his correction, his calling, or his lessons. And we pray things like this, you know? We pray, oh Lord, we receive your Holy Spirit. Baptize us again. Send us your peace. Send us your power. We long for you. We receive you. We receive all your blessings. We receive your healing. But unless we can also say with equal sincerity, bow our knees before God and say, Lord, I receive your correction. Fix me where I'm wrong. Correct me. I don't want to live my life wrong. I don't want to walk in disobedience. Show me where I'm wrong. Lord, I don't value my comfort more than I value righteousness. Unless we can say, Lord, I receive your calling for my life. I receive your direction. Then I don't think we really know what it means to be a disciple. Because blessing follows obedience. We don't ask for all the blessings without providing some of the obedience. It doesn't work that way. And just to make sure that we don't end on a really heavy note, as I was preparing this, I was like, oh boy, Lord, that's a message there. That kind of, you know. I felt like the Lord said, yeah, but make sure you end up with this. Remind my people of my complete, no condemnation, immediate forgiveness. So I don't know, you guys. I don't know where you are in your walk with God. I don't know where you are. I don't know if God is on the throne of your life all the time, or some of the time, or almost never. Maybe you've never invited him to be Lord of your life at all. But what I do know for sure is that if repentance is needed, go to the Lord. Don't wait. Don't just go home and try to do better. Repent. Go to the Lord. Say, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for putting myself on the throne above you. Forgive me. Forgive me for giving into all these different things. I want your lordship. And I have a couple verses and just this little story I want to tell you as we close. I didn't even tell the story in the first two services, but I felt like this was something that the Lord wanted to share with one or two or some of you here. Okay, so maybe you've heard this little example parable before, not sure. But there's this man and he owns a house. Really likes his house. He set it up really nice, the art on the walls, furniture, super nice. And one night, hears a knock at the door late at night, and he goes up to the door and opens it up, and oh, there's Satan standing out there. And before he can slam the door shut, Satan sticks a foot in and gets in the door, and the guy's like, hey, stop, this is my house. And he's like, ah. And he goes in, and he just trashes the place. He flings over the furniture, he breaks down the pictures, and just trashes the place. Has a grand old party till morning. And then when daylight comes, he slips out the door and off he goes. And the man was devastated. He's like, what just happened? This is not good. We can't have this going on. And a little later that day, he hears a knock at the door, and he goes out, and there's Jesus. And he says, oh, Jesus, I know about you. I've heard about you. Boy, I'm glad you came today. I really need you. I just had this crazy thing happen. Would you come and stay with me? And Jesus says, absolutely. I was hoping you'd ask me. I would love to. Where would you like me to stay? And he says, well, actually, I've got this really great guest bedroom upstairs. It's all decorated for company. You can go stay up there. Jesus said, all right, sounds good. I'll see you in the morning. And late at night, there's a knock at the door, and the guy goes up and opens it, and sure enough, there's Satan. And he is thinking pretty confident. He's like, I got Jesus upstairs in my guest room. You know, you can't do much to me now. But to his horror, Satan throws open the door, comes marching in, and trashes the place. He's thinking, what happened? What's going on here? You know, this isn't the way it's supposed to work. In the morning, Satan sneaks out with the first light, and Jesus comes downstairs. And he says, Jesus, I'm so disappointed in you. I thought you would do something. Where were you while he was trashing my house? And Jesus said, I was upstairs in your guest bedroom where you told me to stay. So the guy's like, oh, I understand. Okay, I got this. He said, okay, tell you what. You can go anywhere in this house that you want. Except for this, in the entryway, I have this little closet. And like, you wouldn't want to go in there anyway. You're not missing anything. It's like, there's bad stuff in there. And it's kind of dirty. And just, I don't let anybody see in there. but everything else in the house you just have at her. So then he's feeling pretty confident, and when the knock at the door comes, he goes up and he opens the door and he's like, yeah, okay, you know, me and Jesus, we got this. And wouldn't you believe it, Satan bowls him over, smashes him back against the wall, and trashes the house worse than he's ever trashed it before. And again, he's thinking, what is going on here? This isn't the way it's supposed to work. And in the morning, when Satan leaves and Jesus comes downstairs, he says, what is wrong? What happened? And Jesus says, look, I'll tell you what. Your house isn't worth much right now in this state, is it? He said, no, it's a disaster. He said, tell you what, sign it over to me. Sign the deed of the house to me. And then you can come stay with me in my house. And he said, okay, you know what? I've got nothing to lose. All right, I'll sign it over. So he signs it over. And late that night, knock comes at the door, and it's Satan. And he's about to reach the handle. And Jesus steps up and says, just a second, I got this. It's my house. And he opens the door, and Satan's looking at him, and he wasn't expecting to see Jesus there. And he goes, wait a second. He looks at the house number. Is this the right house, you know? And then he says, sorry, I must have the wrong house number. And he leaves. And that little parable story is just to say that if you feel like there are areas of your life where you have just been beaten up and you're not having victory, maybe what you need is to give Christ full lordship in your life. Maybe what you need is to stop holding on to the closet. Maybe what you need is just to sign it over and say, you know what, I'm not doing a very good job of running this place myself. I'm going to give it to you. You handle it, and I'm going to stay with in your house. This will be your house now. And just remember, if that's you, if you feel like you haven't been doing a great job with this, if repentance is needed, it's forgiveness is there. Listen to these verses as we close. John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Psalm 103:12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed, completely removed, our transgressions from us. And finally, Acts 3:19. Repent then and turn to God, that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. So my prayer for you this morning is the same as what I pray for myself. Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for the times that I've taken you off the throne. Forgive me for assuming it was my life, my money, my decisions. Forgive me. Be Lord of my life. And oh, Lord, baptize me with your Holy Spirit. Fill me with your power. Equip me for your mission. Pour out your peace and love on me as I obey. Right? Thanks.
Wasn't that a great reminder of how we need to make the Lord of our life in every circumstance? Thank you so much for sharing with us, Aimee. Just before we go, just want to make note, the camp banquet is coming up in April. Tickets are available at the Connecting Point. And if you've never made the Lord of your life and you want to do that this morning, we invite you to do that. We're happy to pray with you. We have Bibles available over here. Come see us afterwards. Let's just close in a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you so much that we have the opportunity to come together and hear this amazing word from you. Lord, that you're calling us to put you back on the throne of our life. And Lord, that forgiveness is always available. So Lord, we thank you for this word. We thank you for Aimee. We pray that you would bless her as she goes back to do your work. And Lord, we thank you that we have the opportunity to serve you here in our city, in our location, in our office, and that you are putting people in front of us each and every day that need to hear about your hope. Help us to put you on the throne of our lives, and that we be obedient to the calling that you've given us. Ask that you bless each one of us as we go today. In your name we pray. Amen.